Have you been searching for your purpose? Have you lost hope? Well, I've got some great news for you. Hope is here. Hope is right now. And it's waiting for you. This is Tony McGee, Senior Pastor of Zion Hope Church, and I'd like to thank you for taking time to listen to this word from the Lord. My prayer is that this message will inspire and uplift you today, and I pray that this message will bring you hope. Remember, hope, God's hands on people everywhere, and His hands are on you. Hope is here, hope is right now, and there's hope for you.
Amen. There's a word from the Lord found in the 27th division of Psalms. Psalms 27. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 6 today, and I pray that in your private time that you will read the entire 27th division of Psalms. But for the next few weeks, we're going to focus on these verses, verses 1 through 6. Psalms 27, verses 1 through 6. When you have it, would you please respond by saying amen? Psalms 27, verses 1 through 6. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evil men advance against me to devour my flesh, when my enemies and my foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then will I be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. For in the day of trouble, He will keep me safe in His dwelling place. He will hide me in the shelter of His tabernacle and set me upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At His tabernacle will I sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Today I'm going to preach and teach from the subject of hope when you feel hopeless. Hope when you feel hopeless. Y'all, I was going to preach this entire verses 1 through 6, but I couldn't make it past verse 1. I really couldn't make it past verse 1, so we're going to be parked here for a couple weeks because the Lord's given me the assignment to preach verses 1 through 6, but I just couldn't make it past verse 1. So I want you to please spend some private time alone with God and read the entire 27th division of Psalms. I think that many of you would agree with me that every single day of our lives, we encounter unique situations and circumstances that can leave you with a feeling inside of you as hopelessness, where you have hopelessness in different areas of your life. Some of us may feel hopeless because we are in a seemingly dead-end job where there seems as if there's no room for advancement. You may feel hopeless because your health is not what it was 10 years ago, or your health is not what it was 1 year ago. You may feel hopeless because things may not be going well for you at home. Things may not be going well with you and your spouse, where you can't seem to just get on the same page together. Things may not be going well with your children or your grandchildren or your great-grandchildren because there always seems to be some type of drama going on with them or those who are surrounding themselves with them. And truth be told, Many of us are simply sick and tired of being sick and tired because sick and tired has done nothing but left you feeling hopeless. You're fighting a constant battle, and you say there is no more fight left in you. You've been fighting a constant battle and a constant struggle, and there's no more hope left in you. But y'all, I want to give you some good news and let you know that the way that you may have been feeling over the past few days, the past few months, the past few years, or the past few decades, you are not alone. I thought that would have got an amen. Chances are the person sitting to your right or the person sitting to your left or the person sitting in front of you or the person sitting behind you have experienced some of the exact same feelings that you're feeling right now, but you can't tell it because of the way that they look. But you're not in this thing by yourself. The way that you're feeling is not unique to the person to your left or the person to your right or the person in front of you or the person behind you, because you are not the only one that seems like you have no hope or no more fight left in you. But I've got some really good news for everyone that's come here on today. The fact that you are still here, and the fact that the person sitting next to you is still here, and the fact that the person in front of you and behind you are still here, means that God still has a plan for you, and God still has a purpose for you in your life. If you didn't have a plan that God had for you in your life, you wouldn't be here right now. Y'all, you need to understand that since you are here, God still has a plan for you. Since you are still here, God still has a purpose for you. Since you are still here, God has a plan for your life and a purpose for your life. Because you are not here, you are not like that milk carton that has an expiration date on it. And once you hit the expiration date, you take the milk carton out and you then dump it down the drain and throw it in the trash because it's not good for anything anymore. The fact that you are here, in the midst of your problems, in the midst of your pain, in the midst of your battle, and in the midst of your struggle, means that God has not punched the expiration date on you yet. And as long as you are still here, you have value, you have purpose, and God has plans for you. Y'all, that's the reason you need to have hope, because God ain't done with you yet. Y'all, David, who is attributed to being the author of this psalm, he understood the battles that we have to face on a daily basis. David understood that life is a daily battle. How many of you had to fight to get up this morning? You had to fight against Arthur, and you had to fight against Ritus, and you had to fight against getting your head off that pillow when the alarm came up. And you had to fight against the kids pulling you in one direction or the other. You had to fight to get into that thing that you could. Y'all act like it ain't summertime and you didn't eat over the winter. And you're fighting to get every day, y'all. We have a fight and a battle that goes on in our lives. Life is a daily set of battles. And you and I have to continue to fight. We have to continue to fight. David uses words in this psalm like verse 2. He uses enemies and foes. In verse 3, he uses the word host or army. He says things like war and then enemies in verse 6. All of these words are illustrations that David is painting a picture to us that demonstrates war. All of these are pictures of a battle. And David says, though an host encamp about me, though an army beseeches me, he says, though war begins to rise up against me, David is talking about the war that he is facing in his life. He's talking about war that has been waged against him. David is facing some difficult dilemmas, and he's facing some stressful situations. Yet in the midst of his difficult dilemmas and in the midst of his stressful situations, David still has hope. And the question that I have for all of you that are here today at Zion Hope is, do you still have hope? In the face of opposition, do you still have hope? While you're facing your difficult dilemma, do you still have hope? While you're facing stressful situations, do you still have hope? Y'all, the fact that you are here ought to give you hope. And the fact that God loves you ought to give you hope. And the fact that you know that He has a plan and a purpose for your life in the midst of your battles and your struggles ought to give you hope. And if you came to Zion Hope, you definitely ought to get some hope. Because hope is here. Hope is now, and hope is God's hands on people everywhere. Amen. In this psalm, David gives us reason to have hope while we're facing the difficult dilemmas we have in life and while we're facing the stressful situations that come at us every day. So David shows us that we have hope because first, we have hope because of our confidence in God. David says, my hope is in the confidence that I have in God. His confidence was not in people. His confidence was not in possessions. His confidence was not in his bank account. His confidence was not in how high he climbed in the corporate ladder. His confidence was not in the type of vehicle that he drove. His confidence was not in the house that he lived in. He knew that all God had to do was blow and all of that could be gone. His confidence was in the Lord. And y'all, if you and I are going to be able to make it in this life, and if you and I are going to be able to have hope in the face of hopeless situations, it's going to start by you and I having a personal relationship with God. The relationship that you have with God has to be personal. The relationship we have with God, it has to be intimate. The relationship that we have with God, it has to be real and it has to be authentic. And that's the only way that you and I can have a true hope in the future, is when we have confidence in a relationship with God. Our relationship cannot be fake. I said this on Thursday night. There ain't no future in your fronting. You can't have a fake relationship with God. Your relationship with God must be real and it must be authentic. That's what David said, if we're going to have hope. Well, how can you say that, Pastor? I can say that because David teaches us. When he says, the Lord, he teaches us how to have hope. When he says, the Lord is my light. He says, the Lord is my salvation. He said, the Lord is my stronghold. The Lord is my strength. See, in order for us to have confidence in God, you have to know him and not just know about him. You have to not only confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. You must be willing to follow the direction of the Holy Spirit while getting closer to him. You got to get on your knees and pray to God so you can get to know him. You've got to open up his word, read the Bible, and get basic instructions before leaving earth so that we can know him. It's not enough for us to know about God. We have to know God for ourselves. Oftentimes, we don't have confidence in God because many of us is going to get real quiet. Many of us don't really know him. Many of us don't have a true, real, authentic relationship with him. We've heard stories about God, but we don't have a true relationship with him. We have a relationship that is an on-the-surface type of relationship. You know that type of relationship, you know, when you see somebody every now and then, when they're just good for every now and then conversation, or you know when you call someone just when you need them, or you go to the house only when you need to have a conversation with them, not on a consistent basis. Y'all, and many of us, not all of us, many of us have a surface relationship with God. We come to church every other month. I told you we'll get quiet. We come to Bible study and Sunday school a few times a year. But not hardly often do we come to both. We read the Bible when the preacher says, turn in your Bible to page. And he or she tells you what they're about to preach about. We pray a few times a month when God happens to cross our minds. When we get into a jam that we can't fix our way out of, or we can't buy our way out of it. Then we find ourselves going to him on the surface relationship. Many people don't have confidence in God because they don't have a true, real, authentic relationship with him. I want you to think about your BFF, your best friend forever. Think about your BFF. How often do you talk to them? How often do you go see them? How often do you check in on them? How often do you communicate with them? Okay, y'all don't have BFFs. Think about that person that you've gotten close to at work, or that person that you've gotten close to on Facebook, or that person you done got close to on Twitter, or that person you done got close to on Instagram, Snapchat. How many times do you instant message them? How much time do you spend going from one cubicle to another, developing relationships with people at your job? How many times do you go into your supervisor's office and start shooting the gab with them and talking to them as you're trying to position yourself to climb the corporate ladder? Constantly on the phone, constantly going to the email, constantly emailing them, constantly texting them. You have a relationship with them because you spend time with them. You instant message them. How many Facebook users we got? Y'all don't want to raise y'all's hand. Ain't that shame. Y'all can lie to me, but you can't lie to God. God sees you, and he sees you when you lie. Y'all, you have these Facebook friends because you spend FaceTime with them. How many people do you open up the phone and you FaceTime them? You get to know them get better as you spend time with them. Your relationship grows and you get to know them better. Relationships are built over time. Trust is built over time. Confidence is built over time. So if your trust and your confidence in God is low, you might want to check the time that you're taking to spend with him. If our trust and confidence in him is low, if your trust and confidence in him is high, then this ain't got nothing to do with you. I knew it was going to get real quiet. Pastor Brian came in and shouted, y'all, and now I got to come in. And he told me it was going to be like this. He told me he shouted, y'all. Y'all, trust is developed over time. And this is how we are going to develop more confidence in God, by learning more about him, by experiencing the benefits and the blessings of being in his presence on a daily basis. When you spend time alone with God, you begin to know him. And as you get to know him, you begin to trust him. And as you begin to trust him, the more your confidence grows in him. And the greater the confidence you have in him, the more hope that you will have. By spending more time with God, you will develop hope in the midst of hopeless situations. Amen? You will develop hope in hopeless situations by spending more time with him. And I know you're saying, well, how can you say that? How can you say that, Pastor? How can you back that up? David has confidence in who God is. He knows God. And the confidence that he has in God is he has confidence in who God is. David has confidence in God because his relationship with God is good. Who is God to David? David says, God is my light. He says, God is my salvation. He says, God is my strength. When you know without a shadow of a doubt that God is, not that God might be, not that God could be, but when you know yourself without a shadow of a doubt that God is your light, that God is your salvation, and God is your strength, that's when you will develop hope. Y'all, we sit there and say, I don't have any more hope. I'm not going to make it. You have to know God is your light, God is your salvation, and God is your strength. God is David's light. And as light, God protects and delivers his people from darkness. Okay, Colossians chapter 1, verse 3, 1-13. This is what the Apostle Paul says. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. So David has hope because he knows that God is his light and that God delivers his people from darkness. Okay, you missed your shout. David has hope because he knows that God is light, who delivers his people from darkness. God is light, who delivers his people from dismal situations. God is light, who delivers his people from doom and gloom. God is light, who delivers his people from obscurity. God is light, who delivers his people from shade and from those who are throwing shade on you. God is light, and that's good news to me, and it should be good news to you to know that God delivers his people from darkness. God is my light. You know what? God is my light. David is saying, God is my light because light guides us. And he's saying, God is my guide. More specifically, David is saying, God is my general. It's God who tells me where I'm supposed to go. The Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered by who? Are ordered by the Lord. So we can have hope because even in the midst of hopeless situations, in the midst of battle, in the midst of conflict, in the midst of chaos, we can still have hope because we know that God is ordering our steps. And your steps are not just ordered by God, but your steps are well ordered by God. Your steps, every step that you take, God has a purpose for that step. Every step that you have to make, God has a plan and a purpose for that step. And that plan and purpose is for you to make progress even when you feel like you're in a battle. Every step you take, every step you make, God is ordering those steps so that you can make progress and that you can go forward, not so he can take you backwards. God is ordering your steps. God is your light. God is your guide. And in battle, the general gives marching orders to the soldiers, right? In battle, the general has more experience than the soldiers. The general has a map where he is leading the soldiers to go. The general has knowledge of where the enemy is lurking and where the enemy is hiding. So when the general orders his troops to different places and different stages amongst the battle, he's giving them direct orders for the very purpose of putting them in the right position so that they can be able to get the victory. Every move that the general gives to the soldiers is strategic. Every single move has a plan and has purpose. Even the moves that the soldiers don't understand still have a plan and a purpose. So this means that the general has already thought in advance of a master plan, and he has systematically organized and designed a plan to put you in the right position during battle so that you can get the victory. And even though the soldiers may not understand why the general tells them to go through the dark valley, why the general tells them to retreat, why the general tells them to make a right turn or tells them to make a left turn, why the general sends them in the midst of a storm, they may not understand why he is sending them where he's sending them, but they have confidence in him because because they know him, and they know that every step that they're taking is for them to get the victory. Let me help somebody that's in here today. You don't understand why you're going through the battle, why you're going through this conflict, why you're going through this confusion, why you're going through some dark and dismal times. Why does it at times seem like you have to retreat instead of going forward? Why are there times when it seems like you're getting tossed to and fro? You just keep following God and let God order your steps, knowing that God knows what's best for you, and he has plans to take you to a higher level. Even when you don't understand, you have confidence in him and know he'll never leave you nor forsake you. He'll never put you in a situation that you cannot handle as you stay connected to him. So you will follow his steps in the direction because you know it's designed to give you victory. God has organized every step of your life because what God is doing is God is leading you out of your past, and he's leading you into the present, and he's leading you into the present because he has plans to launch you forward in your future. The steps of a good man, the steps of a good woman are ordered by the Lord, and God is your light. Y'all, God is your light. He's your tour guide. He's your commander in chief. But his word is a lamp unto our feet and a light into our pathway. So as you are traveling through this journey called life, and as you're having to endure the battles that you're dealing right now, physical battles, health battles, emotional battles, family battles, battles at the job, battles at church, battles in the community, battles with guns, battles, and more battles. As you're going through these battles, keep your faith and have hope of knowing that God is ordering your steps, and you don't have to walk around in darkness anymore. Even though everything around you seems to be dark, you don't have to walk around in darkness anymore because God has called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Do I have anyone in here that God has called out of darkness into his marvelous light? And when he called you out, you were wondering and wandering around aimlessly. But once you connected to God and you stopped hanging around those places you used to hang, once you started following his direction, God said, get into my word and come to church. Leave the club alone. God says, put down the bottle and pick up the communion juice, and you put it down. God said, I need you to put down the dope and I need you to pick up the hope. And you put down the dope and you picked up some hope. And as you picked up the hope, he was ordering your steps. You came out of darkness and now you're walking in his marvelous light. You know what you've been through. You know what you came from. You know where you used to be, and you know how far God has brought you. If God has brought anybody out of darkness into his marvelous light, you ought to go ahead and praise him. God is my light. David said, God is my light, and I can have hope. But he also said, God is my salvation. God is my salvation. He said he's my salvation. My salvation. God redeems me, so I have hope. God delivers me, so I have hope. God rescues me, so I have hope. God is my great escape, so I have hope. And I don't know who I'm talking to today, but you've been looking for an escape, and you've not been able to escape whatever it is that's been holding you down and holding you back. But my word to you is, let God be your great escape, because God will save you from what you're dealing with right now. He will save you. He will deliver you. He will pick you up, as the old folks say, turn you around, place your feet on solid ground. Grandmama said, he will. He rescues me. He delivers me. God saves. He is my salvation. And so since he is my salvation, we ought to have hope. Salvation. God rescues us. But you know what? Salvation. God delivers his people from damnation. John 5:24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, this is Jesus talking, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. God saves his people from damnation. Damnation is the state of being in hell as a punishment after death. God saves his people from damnation, from the abyss of the fire, from the eternal, that means forever, y'all, from the eternal torture. God saves his children from eternal torture, from eternal torment, from eternal agony, from eternal pain, from eternal suffering. God saves his children. And that's reason enough right then for us to have hope, because God is our salvation. God saves us from the penalty of sin. God saves us in the presence of sin. And God will deliver us from the ultimate penalty of sin when we are with him in eternity. God is our salvation. God is our salvation. Jesus said, I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. No one can snatch you out of God's hand. Once you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are sealed into the day of redemption. Can't nobody snatch you out their hand. I was helping out and coaching with my son Joshua, who was playing football. And Joshua loved to play football. And he was playing with the 6th and 7th graders. He was playing in the 1st and 2nd grade team. And those of y'all who know Joshua, you know Joshua can be a little rambunctious. Just a little. Joshua likes to hit people, so we put him in an environment where he can hit somebody and not get in trouble. So we put him on a football field, and he can hit someone and not get in trouble. And y'all, these 3rd and 4th graders came up to Joshua before practice, and it was just me and him. And I walked away. I wanted to see what they were going to do. They came and took Joshua's ball, took it away from him. Joshua got mad, wanted to start crying. I said, "Nah, boy. No, they took your ball. You go get that ball." And he said, "Daddy, you don't understand how big these 3rd and 4th graders are." I said, "I don't care how big they are. Go get that ball." I said, "Look, I paid for that ball. You need to go get that ball, boy." He went to go get the ball. And he said, "Daddy, I got the ball, but I hit the guy in his leg. And because he was real big and real tall, and the ball fell out, and I grabbed it, and I brought it back to you." And he said, "I'm telling you because they're chasing me." I said, "Okay, that's cool. Give me the ball." He gave me the ball. The boys came up. Now, this boy was about as big as me. And I'm sitting up there like, this boy's in 3rd or 4th grade? Lord have mercy. I see why Joshua was a little timid. But I said, "Give me the ball." He gave me the ball. I said, "You boys want this ball?" And he said, they said, "Yes, sir, we want the ball." I'm like, "I'm glad you addressed me as sir. I'm taking my boy's ball. Why you take my boy's ball?" They said, "Well, sir, we were just trying to play with him." I said, "You want this ball? Come and get the ball." I handed it to Joshua. And they're like, oh, they got this big smile on their face. And they're like, "We're going to get this ball from Joshua, even though he's tough. He can hit." Right when they were getting ready to take it from him, I grabbed the ball and put it in my hand. I said, "Now get the ball away from me." They tried, and they couldn't get the ball away. They tried, and they couldn't get the ball away. They were able to take the ball from my son. But when my son gave the ball to his daddy, once he gave it to his daddy, it was in his daddy's hand. As it was in his daddy's hand, they couldn't snatch it out of daddy's hand because it was my ball. What are you saying? When you... When you have a relationship with God the Father through his son Jesus Christ, you are safe and secure. And he says, give me the ball. Your life is in my hands. And even though you got some big giants trying to come and take you out, they can't take you out because you are in your daddy's hands. Y'all, when you know Jesus and you are in his hands, I don't care how big those devils are, they can't do nothing with you because you are safe and secure in your Father's hand. And you know what I love about this? This is what I love about it. I love about it, you're safe and secure in his hands. But what I love about this is, Jesus says in John chapter 6, verse 37, he says, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. You missed that. All that the Father puts into my hands, whoever comes to me and you're with me, I will never drive you away. The good news is, once you come to Jesus, whoever comes to him will never be driven away. You're safe and secure forever. It's not just today that you're safe and secure, but you are secure forever. And some people want to tell you, you keep making them same mistakes, your salvation is in question. You keep sinning, your salvation is in question. Y'all, I have to tell you, God loves you. And nothing separates you from the love of God. God may not love what you do, but he still loves you. And since he loves you, when you come to him, your sins will not drive you away from him. Your sins should drive you closer to him. And as your sins drive you closer to him, your relationship with him gets stronger. Then you will confess your sins. And as you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you. And then he'll cleanse you from all unrighteousness. We should not and will not be sinless, but we ought to be blameless, and we got to strive for righteousness. But the good news is, every time you get dirty, God throws you in the washing machine and he puts a little detergent in it, and the detergent is called the blood of Jesus. And once he puts the blood of Jesus into the washing machine, there are times when you're getting cleansed that he may shake you. There are times when you are in the machine that you may get agitated. There are times that you may be getting irritated, but the irritation and the agitation is what God is using to cleanse you, to get the dirt off of you, so that you can be cleansed and be white as snow. When you confess your sins, God is faithful. He is faithful, and he's just that he will forgive you and cleanse you of all righteousness. Is there anybody in here that you've been cleansed by the blood of Jesus? What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Y'all, you are safe and secure. Now don't mistake his patience for permission to continue falling down intentionally. There's a difference between falling to sin and lying in sin. See, when you fall to sin, you fall down, but we get up. Because a saint ain't nothing but a sinner who fell down, but he didn't stand there. He got back up. Y'all, you don't continue to lay in, lie in. Get that when you get home. Walk in sin. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we have to go to Jesus and ask for forgiveness. Then he puts you in the washing machine, throws in the detergent, throws some fabric softener in there so you can smell good. And then he takes you out and you're clean. Once you've been clean, don't go get dirty again. Okay. You've been cleaned. Why do you want to go lay in the same mud puddle that you just came out of? If you know that there's a mud puddle and you see the puddle and you know you're going to get dirty, stay away from the puddle. You know it's there. Certain places you don't need to go. Certain people you don't need to see. Certain situations you need to avoid. If you are not spiritually mature enough to handle them, then once you get spiritually mature, God may use you to go back to the place that he delivered you from to go deliver some other people. But if you ain't been delivered from getting drunk, you can't go to the bar. If you ain't been delivered from getting high, you can't go to the crack house and witness. If you ain't been delivered from that fornication and adultery, you can't go to the strip club. Y'all, you can't. And be effective, you're setting yourself up to fall and to fail. But when you do fall, you can fall forward as you continue to keep your hope in God, because God is ordering your steps. And even though you may have fallen back into the past, it's a springboard to get you into the present when you let him order your steps. So God, David has hope in God because God is his light. And God is his salvation. But this is it, and I'm done. David has hope in God because he said, God is my strength. David is saying, when I'm facing these battles, when I'm dealing with these mud puddles that I continue to trip and fall into, when I keep falling back into old habits, when I keep falling back into an old way of thinking, when I keep falling back into an old lifestyle, that's the time when I have to realize that God is my strength. When I realize that I can't fix my way out of it, I can't think my way out of it, I can't buy my way out of it, I can't lie my way out of it, that I cannot do anything under my own power and strength anymore. When you finally surrender to God and say, God, it is not my will, but it is your will, and I cannot do this by myself. I'm coming to you because you are my light. I'm coming to you because you are my salvation. Now I need for you to be my strength. And when you turn it over to God and you don't have the strength to fight anymore, and you don't have the strength to deal with that temptation anymore, that's when you can say, I can do all things through Christ who will give me my strength. I can't do it by myself, but God, I need you to come in right now. I need to do a Clark Kent. I'm in the phone booth and I'm just a man, but I need for you to come in and put a new uniform on me and step out as being the Superman, because then you can help me to fly over the very things that used to keep me down. Then you can give me the strength to fly over the people that used to put me down. Then you'll give me the strength to look over the situations that I used to wallow in. Then and only then can you receive strength. And when you operate under his strength, when you and I finally decide to surrender, then we can say what Paul said, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Christ Jesus. No matter what you're going through, you know that God will give you the victory. No matter what battles you're facing, God will give you the victory. No matter how many things you're facing right now, family issues, relationship issues, church issues, God will give you the victory. Is there anybody in here that knows that God will give you the victory even in the midst of the battle? He'll give you victory. Even though weapons have been formed against you, no weapon formed against you shall prosper, because he will give you the victory. He'll give you the victory. If God be for you, who can be against you? God will give you the victory. You're not just a conqueror, baby, but you're more than a conqueror, because God will give you the victory. Greater is he who is in you. Greater is he who is in you. Greater is he who is in you. Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. And you have got the victory. Is there anybody in here that would thank God for the victory? Not the victory that he gave you last year. Not the victory that he gave you last night. But the victory that he's giving you right now. Whatever you're facing, you've got the victory. Whatever hurt you're going through, you've got the victory. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. Go ahead and tell Satan to get thee behind, because victory today is mine. Joy is mine. you won't do it. But you can't steal my victory. You can't steal my joy. You can't steal my hope. Because Jesus has given me the victory. Somebody shout yeah. If God has given you the victory, why don't you just say thank you, Jesus? If God has taken care of your health problem, say thank you, Jesus. If God has taken care of your financial problem, say thank you, Jesus. If God has taken care of your relationship, your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, somebody say thank you.